Hello students, Mr. Liddle here. Did you know that in San Francisco we have America's very own Greco-Roman temple? Yes, it's right behind me. It is called the Palace of the Fine Arts. And it is a palace indeed. One of the things that you're immediately drawn to when you look at this is the sheer size of the dome, as well as the great broad arches. The dome itself is actually larger than most buildings in the vicinity. Now today, this dome is mostly associated with prom photos and curated selfies. But its history is actually quite fascinating. It overlaps with the rise of America as a world superpower.
To provide some context, the Palace of Fine Arts was constructed in 1915 specifically for an international event known as the Panama Pacific International Exhibition. However, the Palace of Fine Arts was not alone. In fact, there were 10 additional domed structures specifically built for the fair. A look at the waterfront of San Francisco in 1915 might lead you to believe that in fact it is more Istanbul or Beirut than San Francisco. These 10 additional domes were each used as an exhibition hall, and the Palace of Fine Arts was just one of them. Before we can talk more about the exhibition itself, we should talk a little bit about the dome that's on the top of the Palace of Fine Arts. The architect who constructed the palace, Bernard Maybeck, studied classical art forms in Paris, and this is reflected in the palace itself, the Corinthian columns, the frieze, and the dome itself.
So I'm under the dome at the Palace of the Fine Arts, and I want you to just take a look above me at that geometric pattern that's going on up in there. That's actually a famous design from a church in Italy, from the Baroque era. And so they are attempting not only to channel the ancient Greek motifs and imagery, but also some of that Renaissance iconography and European iconography.
Now, you may not think of a dome building technology in world history terms. That's a very funny term to say, dome building technology. However, the ability to construct a dome was a major historical breakthrough. Historically, early empires built domes by stacking mud bricks on top of each other, and that if the empire was rich enough, they could cover it in something really ornate or pretty. But it was in the Roman Empire that we get our contemporary dome building technology from, and that is via the use of concrete. And you can mold it any way you wish. Concrete is perhaps the greatest Roman invention they have bequeathed to us to this day. So in short, because domes are not a naturally occurring shape, they have to be formed by human hands. This takes a great deal of effort. And therefore, that great deal of effort means that if you have a dome, then perhaps you have a lot of wealth or you have a lot of power. Domes make appearance on many famous buildings worldwide, as can be seen in this very short montage of domes. And of course, there are other elements of the Palace of Fine Arts that put it on par with the great architectural achievements of the human race. For example, the reflecting pool, which looks a lot like the one in front of the Taj Mahal or the Washington Monument. But I wanted to talk about the dome in particular because that's usually the thing that draws people's attention to the palace. Okay, let's talk about the fair. The origins of the Panama Pacific Exhibition is a multi-layered story. The first thing that's really important to understand is that in 1906, 10 years before the exhibition, San Francisco was leveled by a devastating earthquake. In a city of 400,000 people, 300,000 were left homeless and about 1,000 were killed. One of the reasons for throwing this gigantic exhibition was to show that San Francisco is back, baby. Listen to the following account from a fair attendee.
It was the most wonderful thing that ever happened to San Francisco. It stretched from Chestnut Street to the water, from Van Ness Avenue to Fort Point in the Presidio. A marvelous array of cloistered palaces filled with the treasures of the world. The sheltered courtyards and arcades protected visitors from the bay winds and summer fogs. Separated from the rest of the world, open only to the waters of the Golden Gate and the Marin Hills beyond, it truly was a world apart. A world of wonders, of lights.
But more than San Francisco, the fair was a point of pride for the entire United States. Remember, this celebrated the opening of the Panama Canal, a project which linked the Atlantic and the Pacific Oceans together. And while that sounds innocuous enough, this project was funded and designed by individuals from the United States. And in classic American fashion, it was built on land that was obtained via less than ethical means. The United States was a rising world power. It had just acquired a colonial empire in the Pacific. And it's appropriate that this event took place in 1915, while World War I was raging in Europe and all the traditional world powers were at each other's throats. This was such a big deal that then-President Howard Taft broke ground on the site in 1913. Perhaps the crowning achievement of the festival was the Tower of Jewels, a 43-foot-tall building that was studded with hundreds of jewels, so that no matter what time of day it was, it sparkled, and at night, lights shone on it and lit up the entire exhibition grounds. Those additional domes that I mentioned all surrounded the Tower of Jewels, each one of them having their own particular theme. For example, the Industrial Hall featured demonstrations by Henry Ford of his new assembly line, and Ford himself made an appearance in person. Thomas Edison also made an appearance in person to show off his new electrical machines. There was the Horticultural Hall, which showed off plants from all over California. And then outside of the halls, there were all of these booths and stands set up everywhere. The United States had invited 30 nations to come and be represented at the fair. For example, the Japanese booth featured sumo wrestlers and a full-size reconstruction of the Kamakura Buddha, which sits outside of Tokyo. There were aerial acrobatics almost every single day. There were maneuvers on the beaches conducted by the US Marines. There were parades almost every single day, some of which the average viewer could get involved in. And there was even camel racing on a track built just west of the fairgrounds. In many ways, visiting these stalls and these halls would have been like walking into a different world. And one must imagine the festivity. It's hard to imagine the level of festivity and awe and wonder that must have existed since all of these locations have been converted into residential homes. However, the demonstration of world cultures at the Panama Pacific Exhibition also included what we would today consider rather problematic depictions, specifically of cultures from the Pacific Islands, but also Native Americans from the United States. I should note, as a sidebar, the Panama Pacific Exhibition was the first recorded use of a ukulele in North America. But for Native Americans, the most common depiction of them across all stalls and booths was that of the noble savage, who, though great and inglorious, was destined to go extinct or be removed in the face of American might. This is probably best exemplified through a statue that stood right in front of the Tower of Jewels and would not have been missed by anybody attending the fair, called End of the Trail. Seen here, the statue depicts a Native American man slumped over a horse as though he is dying, and the horse itself looks very gaunt. At the time, this was widely seen as confirming the view that Native Americans, though noble they might have been, were destined to go extinct in the face of rising American power. Now, problematic depictions of non-European peoples at these sorts of exhibitions was nothing new. For example, at the Paris Exhibition of 1900, the depictions of their Indochinese colonies was rather stereotypical and not very nuanced. But for the United States, their relationship with Native Americans was different. It's important to keep in mind that memories of the Wild Wild West and conflicts between settlers and Native Americans were still very fresh in the minds of many people. Notions of manifest destiny had driven American politics for almost a century at this point. This was done at the near total destruction and subjugation of Native Americans and their culture. And this choice to show off Native Americans in this particular way raises some interesting questions. Was the exhibition designed to demonstrate American technological power, economic prowess, and might on the world stage? Or was it designed to be a salvo for the rising American century? Even though the United States had spread sea to shining sea, they did not stop there. The Panama Canal's existence was proof of that, in addition to all of the cultures represented from the Pacific Islands that were now under United States control. The exhibition was, in fact, an ambitious vision for the future, a future in which American military and economic power would go on to dominate world affairs. You wouldn't know that, though, just from the basic descriptions of the exhibition, the halls, the cultural centers, the cultural exchange, and the general festivity does not seem to imply a sense of military and economic domination.
That said, those who indulge in selfies and curated imagery are actually partaking in a very long tradition that's connected to this exact building.
It's important to remember this is all highly stylized and curated, both to symbolize San Francisco's bounce back from the 1906 earthquake, but also to demonstrate America's rising power in the world via its subjugation of Native Americans and via its ability to bring all the powers of the world together at a time when most of them were at war with one another.
So the thing to keep in mind about the Palace of the Fine Arts is that in addition to being a physically very impressive structure, the palace served a purpose. which was to put on display America's perceived cultural significance as well as place in the world and world history itself at the turn of the 20th century.
Thank you for watching. If you'd like to know more, please check out the sources listed here.